Hello, everyone. My name is Lucy Chen. I am a senior scientist in Biopharm Science Group in Milford, Massachusetts, with Waters. In today's presentation, I will talk about to utilize our Xevo QTOF platform and unified software to in-depth characterize lysine ADC. Antibody-Drug Conjugate, or ADC, is an increasingly important subclass of antibody therapeutics. And most of the ADC are designed as oncology purpose. And the majority of ADC is composed of three major elements. The antibody part was designed to targeting specific cancer cells. And the drug is a cytotoxic reagent designed to kill the cells when released. And the linker molecule, which helps the drug attach to the antibody. There are three major classes of ADC, which based on different conjugation chemistry. The cysteine-conjugated ADC, which utilize the interchain disulfide cysteine to attach the drug. Lysine-conjugated ADC, which utilize the surface-exposed lysine residue to attach the drug. The third category is called site-specific ADC, which particular design to produce less heterogeneous species for the drugs. So it's interesting to note that there are two current ADC on the market. One is cysteine-conjugated ADC, and one is lysine-conjugated ADC. My talk today will be majorly focused on the lysine-conjugated ADC trastuzumab in Tamsin, although the methodology presented here will be very well adapted to other categories of ADC as well. So among all the critical attributes of ADCs, why do we care about drug locations? There are many studies out there that very nicely demonstrate that the numbers of the drug on the molecule, as well as the location of the drug, has a potential huge effect on the efficacy, toxicity, and CDR binding region efficiency, and also stability and PK of the drug. So it also imposes a potential problem for the ADC manufacturer process control. And I'll show you on the slides as an example. For the cysteine-conjugated ADC, the difference in numbers of the drug attached on the antibody 2, 4, or 8 has a different effect on the efficacy of the drug, showing on the plot on the left, and also has a influence the PK plot on the right-hand side. When we're facing lysine-conjugated ADCs, what are the analytical challenges? Because there are normally more than 60 lysine residues on the monoclonal antibody, and most of them are actually surface exposed that can potentially react with the drug. With the conjugation chemistry happens nearly random, so the reaction chemistry will result in a complex mixture of conjugates that only differs in numbers of the drug on antibody as well as the location of the drug. So the structural characterization is extremely difficult because you're dealing with a highly heterogeneous mixture of these conjugates and potentially very low abundance of the conjugate peptides. And in addition, because the most of the cytotoxic drug are hydrophobic, the increase in hydrophobicity for the peptide are impose a potential problem in recovery when doing sample preparation, which can potentially bias the quantification results. So currently, there's no a good reliable method to calculate the site occupancy of the drug. So the current method for conjugation site determination is LCMS peptide mapping, and for the quantitative is majorly done by UV-based method. So here is the outline of my today's talk. I will introduce the sample for analysis of trastuzumab in Tamsin, or TDM1, and then walk you through the workflow we've been using to analyze the sample. And then I will show the results both from identification for the conjugation sites and also quantification on the conjugate peptide level. So for trastuzumab in Tamsin, or TDM1, is a trastuzumab-based ADC. For the total antibody, there are 19 lysine residues. And the conjugation chemistry is normally done through two-step reaction scheme. And on the slides are showing the structure of the drug and the structure of the linker. The mass of the structure plus the drug are about 956 Dalton. I will show data from this ADC samples from three different resources. This slide shows the intact mass analysis data on the TDM1. The spectrum shows the nice envelope of antibody with 0 to 7 drug attached, and also the linker only peaks right next to the drug peak, about 220 Dalton on the right-hand side. So the intact mass analysis is very important and essential for the antibody analysis. However, from this data, we cannot know where's the site of a conjugation or the distribution of the drug. So we can answer these questions by doing a peptide level quantitation and identification workflow. This slide illustrates the ADC peptide level analysis workflow, both on the identification and quantification side. So for the identification, we use data independent acquisition or MIC method and data dependent acquisition DDA method to confidently confirm the conjugate peptide as well as pinpoint the conjugation sites on the antibody. For the quantification workflow, we use our MIC method designated unified workflow. It called accurate mass screening to monitoring conjugate peptide signals across different injection, across different samples. To note here, I actually use trypsin and aspin, two enzymes, data a little bit differently. I will show detailed results in the following of my slides. So this slide shows some of the experimental details of this study. The LC-MS instrument used for the study is a QED UPLC H-class bio connected to the Zevo G2XS QTOF. And the QTOF can be operated at both MSC or DDA mode. For the data acquisition for MSC and DDA, as well as the data processing and quantification of the sample are all done by unified 1.8 system. So this slide is a summary table for all the identification sites on the lysine conjugate ADC. So I grouped the data by different regions of the antibody, variable Fab, constant Fab, FC, and also listed the available lysine site in each region and list them in the left column in blue. And overall, there are 80 lysine conjugate sites are observed out of total 92 available conjugation sites. And in general, MSC actually ID'd more conjugation sites than DDA. And for the trypsin data, it identified more sites than the aspin data. So I will show next several slides that example of our raw data. So this data illustrate the LC-MS chromatogram comparison between the controlled map, which is trastuzumab, and TDM1. The red trace are TDM1, the blue trace is trastuzumab. You can see here there is actually no apparent difference between the red and blue trace, and the conjugation peptide elution window is actually highlighted in the red box. And if we zoom in this window by 10 times, and you can start to see the conjugate peptide in red are starting to show. So there are two important and interesting characteristics of TDM1 peptides. One is TDM1 peptides are elute in pairs, which due to different stereochemical configurations. And because the drug linkage to the antibody through a myelinamide molecule. And secondly, is the fragmentation spectrum by CID actually produce a common fragments for all TDMM peptides, which is at M over Z at 547. And this corresponds to part of the drug molecule broken down from the antibody drug conjugates and by CID process. And you can also observe the peptide with rest of the linker attached peak here too. And because, like I said at the beginning, that the conjugation chemistry is normally done through a two-step reaction scheme. So they attach the linker to the molecule first and then attach the drug to the linker. So there are actually linker-only peak observed both by intact level and peptide level. So on our intact level deconvoluted mass spectrum, you can see a small linker peak next to the drug peak. And we're able to confirm the unreacted linker peak at peptide level data, which shown in this table, that we have observed three linker-only sites, and they both located in heavy chain, and two of them can be confirmed by both trypsin data and aspirin data. So next, I will show an example of the conjugation site identification with the drug versus with the linker-only compared to the unconjugated peptide. So this is extracted chromatogram of unconjugated peptide versus the linker only with label as MCC and versus with drug and the linker label as in red. The linker only peak is only 0.7% of the whole TEP population. And the B and C and D peak are three pairs of peaks that correspond to three different lysine conjugated with drug, which also shown in the sequence on the bottom. So this slide showing the conjugation site confirmation by our CID spectrum. And each spectrum labeled as B and C and D, you can utilize the BY ions here to pinpoint which lysine here is actually modified with the drug. So the high sensitive and good quality MS-MS spectrum is a key here to pinpoint the lysine conjugation sites. And this slide is also the CID MS-MS spectrum to confirm the linker-only sites on these peptides. And we're able to confirm the linker-only sites both by trypsin data and by aspirin data. So I'm going to switch the presentation from the identification to quantification side. So let's take a moment to think about actually how complicated our sample is. For each conjugate peptide, how many peaks we need to track. So if we consider all the charge state, eta ions, and diastereomers for each peptide, we have to track at least 12 peaks. And considering 40 conjugate peptide per sample, we're facing near 500 peaks we need to monitor across the injection, across the samples. So the way we do this manually is not easy. And the way handling this is utilize a unified quantification workflow called accurate mass screening. It can automatically track all these peaks, injection per injection, sample to sample. And there are another two features of the accurate mass screening workflow that are greatly facilitate this kind of analysis. One is it can combine different charge state and different iodide ions for the peptide. And it also can combine the same peptides from different retention time for quantitation purpose, which is great for this kind of analysis. And this slide illustrates that why we use two different enzymes to do the quantification. And for the trypsin, if the drug is on the lysine residue, the trypsin no longer can cleave at that lysine site. So all the conjugate peptide we identify from the sample are miscleavage peptides. So that all the conjugate peptide from trypsin does not have the same counterparts in unconjugated peptide. And so we cannot use the trypsin data for site occupancy ratio calculation. For the aspirin case, the aspirin peptides actually have the same sequence, the unconjugated peptide versus the conjugate peptide. So we utilize the aspirin data to calculate relative site occupancy. And because trypsin chop at every lysine residue, and it actually break down the conjugation site more evenly. So we using the trypsin data to calculate relative abundance of conjugate peptide across in different samples. And I'll show data from both trypsin and aspirin in following slides. So the first slide showing the results from the aspirin data, and which calculate the relative site occupancy ratio. And this is some selective sites from the whole antibody, which are grouped by different region, lysine, heavy chain Fab, and heavy chain Fc region. The x-axis is lysine site number, and y-axis is relative site occupancy ratio. As we can see here, the different sites actually does have different site occupancy, and in some cases are quite different, close to 5% or above close to 25%. And there's interesting to know here is that this HC65, which is heavy chain lysine number 65, is right located in the CDR binding region. And somehow these sites actually have quite high occupancy ratio than the rest of the sites. Another thing is the Fc region doesn't necessarily have higher site occupancy compared to the Fab region. So we have this set of interesting samples that are coming from three different companies and five total samples. And for company A, we have batch 1 and 2. For company C, we have a different process chemistry to attach the drug to the antibody. So we're able to compare the conjugate peptide relative abundance across these five samples. I group them by different regions of the antibody. The top plot is for a variable Fab region. The middle plot is for constant Fab region. And the bottom one is for Fc region. As you can see here, the company batch 1 and 2, are pretty consistent with each other in three regions. And one interesting to know is the bright blue color, which indicates a company C process 2, the same as all layer in all three regions. For example, in a variable Fab region, the bright blue are significantly higher in this region than rest of the sample. This is trypsin data. We're able to confirm variable Fab region by both trypsin and aspin data. If you look at the aspin data results, the trend matches very well with the trypsin data, which prove of reliability of our method. I hope I have convinced you that we are utilizing our Zevo G2XX QTOF with unified platform to identify and quantify those conjugate peptides of lysine ADC. And particularly, we use peptide mapping workflow to identify the lysine conjugate peptides and confirm the drug conjugation sites. And we utilize the accurate mass screening, which is a quantification workflow, and efficiently monitor all these peptides abundance across samples and determines the relative site occupancy from the aspin digest sample. So the presented unified workflow here is also applicable to other type of ADC characterizations. For acknowledgement, thank you very much for the pharmaceutical group and informatics group in Milford for their support during the studies. And thank you very much for your attention.